It's day 8.
One turd of the way through the calendar.
Oh.
A turd of the way through already.
Baby wants a new spin. Baby wants a broken heart. Yeah, you found a linchpin to keep it all from falling apart. But you keep
on going. We're back. And it's day 6.
No.
No!
Now grab a little bottle.
Oh. No, that's not right either.
Yeah.
8?
Yeah.
Oh.
So back to Irish, right? Getting into some age statement whiskeys now. Well, we did that a little bit with Bird Dog at 7.
Yeah.
But, you know, I think by now you're finishing up the first third. Palate should be getting refined. Moving towards veteran status slightly. And I have an interesting one. So I'm kind of excited to try this one. So, you know, those of you who are pretty familiar with the bourbon scene probably know of MGP. So Midwest Grain Products in Indiana. So MGP... this is probably one of the largest, if not the largest, producers, at least independent producers of spirits, mostly bourbons and ryes in the U.S. So a lot of the bourbons that you find on shelves today were created by MGP.
They're
source bourbons.
Yeah.
And they're great bourbons. There's some really good stuff there. And actually, you know, we're going to get to a whiskey a little bit later from Greg Metz at Old Elk, who used to be the master distiller at MGP for many years, and we got to meet Greg.
We did.
Probably the second coolest dude named Greg that any of you know or would know. Right?
That's how I feel, at least. Yeah.
I hope so. So in Ireland, we kind of had the same thing going on. So there was, you know, the Irish whiskey industry was huge. There was more Irish whiskey sold worldwide than Scotch whiskey for the longest time. Irish used to be the premier spirit in the world, due to like triple distillation, craftsmanship, etc. I know Scotch people say no, it didn't happen. But there was a combination of events with the Irish War for Independence in 1916. Then there was the World Wars. There was an embargo from Britain after the independence, all of which of prohibition in the U.S., which I think Haley knows a lot about prohibition. That can be your shout out for later.
Okay.
But anyways, all of those things conspired to really wreck the Irish whiskey industry. And at one point, they were down to really just 2 or 3 producers left in the country. A bunch of them came together who used to be rivals and created Irish Distillers, which is Jameson, Powers, you know, the Redbreast line, Mitchell and Sons. Then you had West Cork, you had Cooley, and then even like Tullamore Dew and some of those all went Bushmills. You always had Bushmills up in the north, Narn Iron. But all of that to get around to saying this, I believe, is a sourced Irish whiskey. It's 10 years old. There aren't a lot of distilleries in Ireland that were around 10 years ago. Like Dingle's been around now for 8 years. They were the first purpose-built distillery in Ireland in over 200 years. So that should tell you. So this is Hinch 10-year-old Irish single malt whiskey. So we had a single pot still with Kilbeggan. We went through all of what makes single pot still.
Yeah.
This is a single malt, so just malted barley, aged in used oak barrels on the island of Ireland for 10 years. You've got 43 horsepower or 86 proof.
Okay.
All right?
Yeah.
You want to start getting in there?
Yeah. I'm having a little bit of a hard time.
So Hinch is a, I'm going to flutter for a little bit longer. What's up, buddy? Hinch is a new Irish distillery. It's in Northern Ireland. I believe the town is Ballyhinch. Where it gets the name Hinch. Bally, I believe, used to come from... because you find a lot of Ballys. Ballyferritor, Ballycotton, Ballyhinch. I believe it comes from the old English word meaning bailey, which used to be a fort. So they had these forts, which became towns. So just south of Belfast, so Northern Irish whiskey. This is bourbon and sherry cask matured whiskeys. Produced, I believe, by Great Northern or maybe Bushmills. My money is on that this is a Bushmills whiskey.
All right, so I'm still not getting a ton, but I get a little bit of vanilla. Just doesn't have a strong, right? There's, I don't want to say that there's not a lot to it, because I have a feeling once we taste that it's going to be completely different, but you're not... I'm not getting all kinds of, like, floral notes or anything like that, but...
So, and this is why I like Irish. So, Irish, at the beginning, and I'll be honest and transparent, candid, it's easy drinking. And if you just think of Jameson, but because it's typically a lighter, refined spirit because it's been distilled three times, it's an easier drinking whiskey than a big, bold bourbon or rye or even a scotch. You go, girl. But the other thing why I like Irish is you get into whiskey, it's that lightness, the layering, the complexity that's going to make you fight a little bit to find out what's in there. But on the nose for me, it's just, it's very light, vanilla, sugar, a little bit of some orchard fruits. So I think that's coming from the Oloroso sherry cask component. But you go ahead.
Yeah, I went in. So, I got, I don't want to say heat, I got like a cinnamon at the very beginning, and then I got the stone fruit behind it. More like a plum, like the deeper, richer fruits that you would think of. Maybe blackberry as well. It's good.
I'm very just light.
Yeah, I'm having very a light. Hard time pulling... So again, pulling out what I'm getting.
To me, there's like a pear component in there, like a sugared pear, like lightly sugared pear. It's sweet, a little decadent, a little bit of hint of chocolate. Where I think that's coming from, and it's there's this tannic dryness on the palate, which I think is really pushing from that Oloroso sherry. Barrel influence. So the vanilla, the sugary taste is coming from the bourbon, but it's cool listening to your tasting notes on it because you're calling out things that are traditional sherry cask components in a whiskey. But to me, this has to be we're gonna have to, I think we're all out. Oh, I didn't show I didn't show the bottle. But I'm getting really bad at this. we gotta try this next to a Bushmills 10. Because to me excuse me, this is it presents to me like a Bushmills. I like it. It doesn't blow me away, but
No, it's just like a easy, straight, it has nuances, but it's not all over the place, I feel like.
Yeah. I will say I bought their five-year-old, I believe it's the five-year-old, or their single pot still. Maybe it's their non-age statement single pot still. Wasn't totally impressed with it.
Yeah.
But this is an easy drinker. It's not exciting, I will say that.
No.
But... it's also, there's good balance to it. Like we've had some other whiskeys that, you know, maybe were a little more interesting, but I wouldn't say balanced. Yeah. And something that I haven't gone back to. Like I would go back to this. This would be on the shelf, something that I'd pull, or on the cupboard, in the cupboard, something that I'd pull out, you know, kind of frequently and drink.
And I wonder if we go back to it, right, in a little while. If it tastes different to us. Like, I get that feeling from it, that as I take more and more sips, I tend to taste different things.
Yeah, you're right. Because now it's just different. Like, to me, it's like red berries with cream.
Yeah.
you know, like fresh red berries and like not cheap ass cream, like good cream.
Look, heavy cream.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And one thing, I should have mentioned this earlier, we can't do it because we want you to see the action of us opening a little nip. But one of the things I'd encourage you to do is look at the age statement on the whiskey. So like this is a 10-year-old, pour your whiskey and just let it sit for those 10 minutes. Let it kind of breathe a little bit, let it expose itself a little bit. It tends to present, I think we just almost drank all of it. I got to save just that little bit for the toast. But no, actually, as we get into this a little bit more, I do.
Yeah.
I'm picking some things up.
On yeah, it. It gets, huh? It's layering yeah. itself, I feel like, yeah. the more I drink it.
All right. So this one, $50. So for 10-year-old whiskey, not a bad price point. I think that's kind of fair. Usually, once you get above 10 years, you can pretty much expect about $5 to $10 per year. So 15 year would be another $25 to $50. So, you know, this at 15 years old would probably be a $100 bottle.
Yeah.
Generally speaking. All right. Shout out.
Tonight is our friend and neighbor, Haley Breggy. And we're ready for the toast.
Oh, sure.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah? Yeah. All right. May your heart...
I just didn't know if you were going to make some reference to Prohibition again.
I wasn't.
Okay. All right. What about hiccups?
Maybe hiccups.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
So without hiccups, all I'm right. going to say, may your heart stay young, the whiskey be old, the cork loose, and the adventures bold.
And we will see...
Yuns later.
Cheers.
Cheers.
I liked it.
Yeah.